Very good evening and a very warm welcome to all the faculties and students from various institutions and one and all present here. I am Architect Harshita, Assistant Professor at AAAD, will be your moderator for today. Before we begin with the session, I would like to make a couple of announcements to the participants to ensure an uninterrupted interactive session. All the participants are requested to unmute the audios and videos and interact if any questions are there during the session, and it will be answered during the session. Thank you for your cooperation and kind attention. Now I request Architect Siddhartha to play the video. Thank you, sir. Now, I would like to call upon Architect Arunachal and Architect Kishan from AAAD to present a lecture on generating plan, elevation of objects, dimensioning of objects, and study of building materials and construction. Floor is yours, sir.
Thank you, Arshita. Thank you very much. Yeah. Hi, everyone. Can we just see you?
No,
all
sir.
The students? Can you I can see Kirtana, Gunashri, Vibha. Hi, Sandesh. You can talk, man. Sandesh, Kritika. Yeah, that's good. Tejas. Yeah. Nice to see a few of you. Yeah, let us, you know, just 5 minutes, let us talk, okay, before starting the session. So, Kishan is joining me. Kishan? Yeah. I can see Ranjita. Yeah, many of you can on your videos. I mean, whoever can on. Sudarshan, Deepika, Nisarga. Yeah, it's good to see you guys, you know, before we start.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, good evening, sir. How are you? Yeah, Jagdish sir also has joined us. It's nice.
Sorry to interrupt. So I wanted to know how the...
Sir, please, sir. You're welcome, sir. Sir, why? Sorry, sir. Sorry, sir. You're most welcome.
Okay, sir.
Hey, now, students, before we start, I think you saw a video now, right? It was played. Okay. So can we just know your hobbies? Kritika?
Yes, sir.
Can you just tell your hobbies, please?
My hobbies are dancing, singing, drawing.
Very nice, very nice. Drawing, is it?
Yes, sir.
What do you like to draw?
Sir, normal, just painting, sketches and all.
Very nice. See, it's the beginning of our, you know, architecture.
Correct.
Sandesh? You like cricket, Sandesh? You watch cricket?
Yes, sir.
Very good. See, stadium. You understand? Crickets are played in stadium, right?
Yes, sir.
Again, it is architecture. Okay. What are your hobbies, Sandesh?
Sir, watching movies, sir.
Oh, very good, man. Other than movies?
I play drawing, sir.
No, no. Just because on this forum, you need not tell drawing. I mean, if you do, you can tell. Okay.
No,
feel free.
Sir, I do. Yes, sir.
Very good. Very good. Yes, no, no. I did see your works. Okay, Sandesh, Kritika, I remember a few things what you guys have done. Ranjita, you're on video. Can we know your hobbies, Ranjita?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please.
I like to do paintings.
Oh, painting. Oh, everybody is interested in painting and drawing. That's nice. I mean, nobody mentioned traveling, I say, as a hobby. All of you like to travel, is it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's where, yes, you know. Yeah, so that's very important. See, now you saw a video. Okay, I mean, abroad, Malaysia. You understand? So traveling is a very, very important hobby. And I mean, I'm sure everybody likes traveling, is it? Dhaneshwar? You like to travel, Dhaneshwar?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, see, sitting at home, we can't experience anything, no? So we need to travel. So if we travel, what happens? The environment will change. You see a place. I mean, traveling can be anything. You can go to a temple, any religious building. You're going to a mall, right? You're going to a cricket stadium to watch cricket. Hope you're understanding, right? You might have gone to some resort, some hotel. So everything, I mean, you're seeing some buildings. So everything is a traveling, basically. You understand? So traveling is a hobby, I mean, which is very important. Okay. I think we'll start the... Let's sharing the slides. See, we want it to be more interactive. You understand? Kishan?
Yes, sir. I'm here, sir. Yeah.
Kishan, full screen, madappa.
Kishan, make it full screen and then slide, share, screen share.
How is it visible, sir?
Yeah, now it is visible. Now it's visible. Yeah, we'll get started here. See, first of all, let us understand, you know, what is architecture. I mean, many speakers have told you guys what is architecture, but this is one more to explain what architecture is. See, usually what happens is, you know, whenever I teach students, actually I draw two circles. Okay. So one circle is the education circle. The yellow circle is a practice circle. Practice means when you are practicing architecture. Okay. So you can see the overlap here. So I'm just trying to, you know, hatch the overlap here. So the overlap is too much, especially in medicine and architecture. Whatever we learn, actually we practice. That means it is useful to construct, or the ideas whatever we learn are very useful. So we can say that, you know, architecture and education, there is a big overlap of 70%. That means whatever we learn in architecture, we are really practicing. May not be, you know, true in many other courses like our medicine. It is very relevant here. Okay. So what I would like to start my presentation is, see, what we learn, we build. Okay. So 5 years of course will make you a practical architect. Okay. That's one thing. Okay. Now, what is important? What is very important in architecture is observation. Okay, what is the meaning of observation? Till now, you are seeing things. Okay, you are seeing things. You are roaming around the cities. You are going around places. But what happens is, when you start learning architecture, your observation, precision of observation becomes better. You will know what to see. See, now you would have gone, most of you would have gone to Orion Mall. Most of you would have gone many, many other places. So from house to Dubai. So I'm mentioning as house to Dubai. Means, you know, starting from the house, maybe anywhere else. So you need to observe. Okay, you need to observe what you're seeing, what is happening around you, okay, where you're spending time and all that. So observation is the very, very important factor. Because see, in architecture, we learn by seeing buildings. Okay, theory part is one. But the mainly architecture of how we learn is, the buildings are already built. May it be malls, may it be any other building, institutional buildings and all that. So buildings are already there. They're existing. Okay, there's nothing that, you know, you need to learn new about them. But you can see them, observe them, and you can keep learning. Okay, so how does it happen? So you've already seen, you know, the Aditya school that, you know, we have taken students to many places, even abroad. So these things are very important. So this exposure, what we call, is very, very important to students. May it be the exposure of Indian cities, Karnataka, because see, architecture varies region to region. This exposure is very, very important. That's why, you know, in our curriculum, we have study tours. Okay, that is one point. Second important point, what I want to tell you guys is, see, in an architecture curriculum, there are visiting faculties, the practicing architects come and teach. So that is, you know, that is where, you know, you see the, you know, overlap here, where whatever you learn and whatever you practice, they're so nearing. And even all many faculties who are teaching architecture are also practicing. So if I, the first slide, what I'm meaning to tell is, what we learn actually is what we build. Okay. Kishan, next. Okay. I think many of you know the definition of architecture here. Architecture means arts plus science. Okay. So the science component we are going to touch here, because our topic is construction today. So let us understand what is science in architecture. See, according to me, we have divided science into two. That is, understanding the materials is one, which is very, very crucial. There are thousands of materials, okay, available. So understanding them is one thing which is very crucial, and understanding construction as such is very, very important. How does the construction happen and all that, that is very crucial. Okay, so both these play a very important role in architecture. So what I would like to tell is, we design to build, we imagine to build, so we create to build. See, for example, you can see this building. Okay. So it's a very it's a building which is built. It's a museum which is built already. So you imagine something, it can be built. You create something, it can be built. So that is the main difference between art and architecture, where architecture, you need to build. You need to build whatever you perceive, you need to build. It's not that, you know, I'm imagining something and it remains as an imagination. Okay, it doesn't become a cutout on the wall where I imagine something and I'll sketch and keep it on the, you keep it on the wall, but you need to build it. So that is where, you know, the main striking difference between an architect and an artist is, we need to build it. So the component of art also is equally important, and science is again very important. So the mixture of two, basically, that is art and architecture, is what is art and science, sorry, is what is architecture. Yeah, Kishan, next. Okay, I want some interaction here from all of you. So I think many of you are, you're staying in residences or apartments or whatever it is. So I would like to, give some very basic introduction about the components, what you see, okay, in the world. So this is the gate. This is the gate where we open and go inside the house. We call it as gate. This is the compound wall, which protects the house. Okay. These are the external walls. You can see this. This we call it as external wall. I'm drawing it in red. See, parallelly, when I tell that this is an external wall, you might have heard this word called elevation. Okay. So, for example, if I decide to this wall, so what is there in this wall? Can anybody speak out? What can I see in this wall? What I have drawn in red now? Yeah, very good. So you can see windows in the wall. Then what else can you? I mean, whoever answered now. When I said that this is the elevation of this wall from external, what else can you see?
Roof.
Very good. So you can see a sloping roof there. Okay. So what is an elevation basically? Elevation is the external view. When you are standing here, when the person is standing here, okay, and he sees this. So this is called elevation. So in this wall, basically, what I'm trying to see is the three windows and the sloping roof. Sorry, I'm trying to clear it. Okay. So all of you are staying in residences and all that. So these are the internal walls. Okay. The internal walls are the walls, the partition walls, what we call. They are usually in between, bedroom and kitchen, or bedroom and toilet and all that. Okay. So I'm very sure you know that this is called as door. Okay. All of you would have observed the doors, your entrance door or your bedroom door or your toilet door, etc. These are called windows. Okay, can anybody tell what are windows? What is the use of windows?
Purpose of ventilation.
Kirtana, I think Kirtana.
Ventilation.
Okay, only ventilation, Kirtana, or something else?
Like we'll get more lights or like.
Very good, yeah. So, we need windows. Okay, windows are there. We need windows. So, we learn windows to a greater detail in architecture. So, we all know that, windows have different materials, and what slide is shown here is basically it's a wooden window, and you all know that this is called a floor, we try to walk and all that. So again, a lot of materials, floor, flooring and all that. So I thought this is basic introduction about what a house is. Let us move on. Okay, now let us, get a little more technical about this. See, when we talk about construction, architectural construction, there are mainly two kinds of constructions happening all over. One is called load-bearing structure, which I'm going to explain in the beginning now. So what is load-bearing structure? Please listen carefully. So in load-bearing structure, this is a slab, right? This is a slab. There is a load. There is a load of this slab, okay, coming downwards. A load of this slab is coming downwards. Ultimately, the whole load is going to the foundation. Now, one thing you can observe here that there are no columns here. Okay, so it's clearly mentioned in the slide that there are no columns. Then one may wonder, what takes load? Because you guys may be, you might have listened to columns and beams and all that. But this building does not have it. Okay. So that means to say that there is something else what takes the load. So what takes the load here? Anybody can guess? What is taking the load of the roof here in this sketch?
Wall.
Yaneshwar? Very good. Very good. That's very nice. So see here, the wall is taking the load of the roof. That means this roof load is falling on the wall. Ultimately, this roof load is falling on this wall. So ultimately, the load is going to the foundation. So in a load-bearing structure, let us conclude that there are no columns here. as well, beams may be there, but in this particular sketch, beam is not there in this particular example. So beams may be there, I'm again repeating, but columns won't be there. Okay, the load of the roof, what we call it as a dead load, and live load is load of furniture, load of people, etc., is taken by the external walls. So when walls take the load, it's called as load-bearing structure, not the columns. So you can see one more example here, which is showing a roof, a slab, and walls. So it's very clear. Again, I'm mentioning that load is taken by walls, okay, as there are no columns here. Okay, next. This is called load-bearing structure. Yeah, I've tried to, you know, represent it better in a sketch form. So this is the dead load of these slabs going down. You understand? And this is the wall. So basically, this load is transferred to the wall and in turn to the foundation. That's how it is. See, I'm okay if anybody wants to ask anything in between. Okay, I'm absolutely okay with that. Okay. You can tell, excuse me, sir, and you can ask. Okay, let us move on. Huh, see here now. So now, the second kind of structure, what we are going to understand today, is frame structure. See, all of you might have seen some or the other construction around you going on. So what is a frame structure? See, in the frame structure, as we clearly told in the previous slides, wall does not take the load. Wall is not the load taking factor at all. What takes the load? Dhaneshwar? Can you just try? What is the load taking factor here, Sangeeta?
Sir?
Yeah, what is the load taking factor here? What takes load here?
Column.
Slab load and all that. Ah, very good. See, slab beams, load, column. Beams and columns. So basically in a frame structure, load is taken by beams and columns. In turn, it passes through foundation. You can see this sketch very clearly. We have beams, we have columns, and in turn, the load is passing to the foundation. So this is called frame structure. I'm again repeating my statement. In frame structure, the load is carried by beams and columns to the foundation. Okay. Now, what are these internal walls? These internal walls just behave as, that's all. I mean, they don't have any role in taking the load. That's what I want to communicate. They don't have any role in taking the load. Okay. But why do we need external walls? Yeah, we need external walls for safety, right? Because see, somebody should not break the wall and come inside. So when it comes to a safety concern, we say the external walls are not load-bearing walls, but external walls have to be thick enough. Okay, further slides I'll just explain. External walls have to be thick enough as a protection from wind, sun, and safety from people. Okay, so this is how it works. So basically, now again, I'll just repeat. Harshita, you wanted to tell something?
No, sir.
Okay, so basically, I wanted to, I'll just, you know, explain the differences again. Next slide. Yeah, so the clear-cut difference we are seeing here in this slide, the difference between, in the superstructure, the difference between load-bearing structure and frame structure. So I hope it is very clear to you, both the, it's a self-explanatory, both the photos are talking to themselves, that there are no columns here and there are columns here. Okay, we will move forward. Okay, so let us just spend some time here because it's very, very important for you guys to understand what are the components in the building. Okay, now let us start from bottom. Let us start from bottom most. So this is basically, you know, ground floor. Okay, you're all aware that, you know, wherever houses you're staying, they're not just on the ground as it is. They're raised one step or two step or three steps, whatever it is. They're raised from the natural. Can anybody tell me why we should raise the building, which is called as plinth? Aditya?
to increase the lifespan of the house, sir.
Lifespan, is it? Achha, achha. Lifespan means what, man?
Sir, it should be strong until when rain and...
very good, wind. Very good. See, that's the perfect answer. Okay. So why we need to raise the building on plinth is to protect from water. That obviously, you know, increases the lifespan also. So let us start now. See, this is the ground level. So we are raising the building. So basically this level is called plinth level. Please pay attention. It's very important. This level is called plinth level. Where the building sits at the raised level is called plinth level. Okay. Then all of you, I mean, you're aware that, you know, you have seen windows in your own houses. You can observe whatever I am telling. So the window bottom level is called as sill level. You understand? Window top level is called as lintel level. Okay, I am again repeating. Plinth level, where the building is sitting, the raised platform is called plinth. Then next is the sill level. What is sill level? The window where it starts, no? That level is called sill level. Again, heights may vary according to the design. It may be 1 feet or 2 feet or whatever it is. Okay, 2.5 feet is the standard, but it may still vary. So window bottom is called sill level and window top is called lintel level. This is very important. See, all of you can observe in this slide, window top and door top are same usually. You can, in fact, you can, if you're sitting at your houses, you can just turn around and see whatever I'm talking. It becomes more relevant and you'll understand it better. So you can see the lintel level. Usually what happens is the door top level and window top level are same. So that is called lintel level. Okay. And the standard is around 7 feet. That is 2.1 meters. I'm again repeating, the standard lintel level in our Indian condition is 7 feet, that is 2.1 meters. We'll go on next. So this is called roof level. Okay. I'm sure you've heard about the word called roof. Lata? You heard the word called roof? Okay. So this is called roof. Okay. Then this is called ground floor. So whatever is there in the ground is called ground floor. Now we'll come to the first floor. So this, the second floor, the floor above is called first floor. Again, the things are same. This is sill level. This is lintel level. And this is again roof. Okay. I would like to say a few more things here. So you when you see a building outside, means the building is still here. I'm trying to draw a section. The building is still here. So this is open to sky. This is open to sky. I can stand here, okay? I can stand here, I can sit here and all that. This is open to sky. So this is called terrace. So wherever the building portion is open to sky, where you can sit on it, is called terrace, okay? Any doubts here? I would like to spend 2 minutes here if you have any doubts. And foundation is shown here. So basically we see a foundation, we see a plinth level, we see a sill level, we see a lintel level, we see a roof level. Very, very basic levels. And even, you know, some kind of flooring is shown here and all that. See, what is railing? So usually when we have balconies, no, railings will be there. Okay, let us move on. No problem. Yeah. Next slide. Okay. Okay. Let us now concentrate on building materials. Okay. So what are the basic building materials which you guys need to know at this basic stages? See, construction materials are divided into two. One is the natural materials and one is the artificial materials. So what are the natural materials of construction? You already know what is wood. Wood. We know clay. We have rocks and we have sand. Okay. What are the artificial materials? What are made from these natural materials? We have cement, we have lime, we have bricks, we have stone, we have ceramics, we have glass, we have paints, we have plastics, and we have tiles or marbles. Okay. So I'm sure this is very clear to you. Why they are natural materials? Because they are available naturally. Okay. Why they are artificial? Because they are man-made. As simple as that. Okay. So can anybody answer this clay, where is it used in a building material? Where is the clay used to make what? Kritika? No, if you don't know, you can say, sir, I don't know. Absolutely no problem. Sandesh?
For making bricks, sir.
Ah, very good, Sandesh. So, clay is the main ingredient of bricks, to make bricks. Okay. So, all the building structures are composed of different types of materials. These materials, either they are called as building materials or materials for construction. So, these are the important materials what are listed down here. We will take them one by one and learn how these materials behave in architecture and construction. Yeah, next slide. Okay, I think we'll start with brick first. I'm sure all of you have seen bricks. Okay, I'm sure you know you've seen some construction where the brick is the most commonly used material, okay, to build walls. Let me just explain to you the brick first. In your terms, brick is actually a cuboid, okay? So it has got length, breadth, and height. It is rectangular in form. So as you can see the sketch here, the longer side of the brick, this is the longer side of the brick, okay? So the dimension, our Indian standard dimension is 230 mm. This is the breadth of the brick, which is 115 mm. And height is 75 mm. Okay, so 230 by 115 by 75 is the height of the brick. Okay, now let us concentrate here. See, I have tried to, you know, mark the depression in the brick here, which is there on the lot there. So this depression is called frog actually. Okay, so what is frog and why frog? That you can see it later. Okay, there's a depression in the brick called frog. Okay, then let us see later why the frog is there and you know, what is the use of the frog. So this, the longer dimension of the brick is called stretcher. Okay, the shorter dimension of the brick is called header. So these things are very important for you. What is stretcher and what is header? The longer side of the brick, I am again repeating, the longer side of the brick is called stretcher. The shorter side of the brick is called header. Okay. Yeah, we'll move further. So the hard blocks, okay, one second. So the bricks are mainly made out of clay, baked clay. So some, you know, pictures, the kiln where the bricks are burnt. So we have just tried to show some pictures. See, mainly there are different kinds of bricks, but what I would like to highlight here at present is, you know, sun-dried bricks, which are the basic bricks, which are dried in the sun, okay, after molding them by clay. Next is the burnt clay bricks, like how they are burnt in the kiln. The third one is the wire cut bricks. Okay, these wire cut bricks are basically factory made bricks. They are more to precision. Okay, they are the angles, the edges are very sharp and neat. Okay, if you want to understand the cost difference between these two bricks, I'll just tell you, if this brick is around 9 rupees, this brick is around 24 rupees per brick. That is the kind of ratio of cost difference. It is more than double. Now, why is this? Because this bricks can be exposed to sun. I need not plaster it. Further slides, I'll explain to you what is plastering. I need not plaster these bricks. I can just leave the bricks exposed. So that is the advantage of wire cut bricks. Okay, now let us understand, you know, a few more technical things about bricks. This is called full brick. One second. This is called full brick. When we cut the brick into two, so I already told you that this is 115, and this is 230, the longer side of the brick, which is called stretcher. When you cut the brick into two on the stretcher, when you cut the brick into two on stretcher, like you are seeing in the picture, it is called queen closure. It is called queen closure, or we also call it as half queen closure. Okay. When we cut the brick again, this brick into two, that has become 1/4 now. It is called as queen closure quarter. I'm again repeating this because this is, unless you understand this, we can't move to further slides.
Nothing, sir. I think you can go ahead.
I'm not seeing this one. I'm not seeing the connection problem. So all of you have understood this? The cutting of the brick, Kirtana?
Yes, sir. I've understood.
Yeah, you understood it, right? So if you cut the brick, on the stretcher side, it's called closure, queen closure. Then further, I'll just explain. Siddharth, just call him and see. Otherwise, I'll share.
Yes. Until then, guys, you guys have any doubts, you can just discuss
Can just have an interaction. Yeah, we can just have an interaction. There is some connection error. No problem. We'll just wait for 1 minute. Yeah, somebody wants to ask something? Very good. So I was just telling that, this is the bricks cut on larger axis. It's called as queen closure. Okay. So when we cut the brick on the shorter axis, it's called as bat. Okay. It's called as brick bat. I'm again repeating. When we cut the brick on the longer axis, I'll just use some other color, I feel. When you cut the brick on the longer axis, it's called as queen closure. So this is the full brick. So when I cut the brick into two, now this is the brick. This is the half brick, what we have got. So that half brick is called bat. Okay. Just let us move on further. So all of you can see there are, the different courses of the brick. How they are kept one on each other. Okay. And this is the mortar. We have a layer of brick and we have a layer of mortar. We have a layer of brick and layer of mortar. So this is, what is this line? The black line. What does the black line indicate? So the black line indicates that, there are no vertical joints here. For example, see, I can't have a brick here. And I can't start one more brick right on top of it. Okay. So that means, there is no vertical joint. That means what happens is, the brick wall can fall on this side. So there's no interlocking basically. Okay. So whenever we build a brick wall, different courses, so we need to avoid this vertical joint. So what is done here? The brick is kept here and the brick is kept staggeredly here and one more brick here in the next course. So basically, as we go on to the different courses, the bricks are kept staggeredly to avoid the vertical joint. This is again a very crucial thing to understand. So I have tried to put a slide here. This is the brick wall. Okay. This is the plaster. This is called putty, the white portion. Then this is called paint. So ultimately, what you are seeing in your houses, the finished product, is you are seeing the brick walls painted. Okay. But inside this, all this happens, that putty, plaster, and you can see the brick wall. So whatever plastering is done is above the brick wall. Then we do a coat of putty. Then we paint the brick wall. Okay. Next. I think you can disable this one, Siddharth.
The administrator can disable it.
Okay, now let us come to this, the bonds in the brick. I mean, how do we make bonds? First one is the stretcher bond. Okay, stretcher bond is nothing. I already made a mention that this is the stretcher. This is stretcher. The longer side of the brick is called stretcher. I've already made a mention. So when you just keep the stretchers facing the stretcher on both sides, it is called stretcher bond. So you can see it very clearly in this 3D. Take 5 seconds and just see this. You can understand what I'm trying to tell. Basically, again, we are trying to break this vertical joints here. Okay. Now let us come to the English bond. Okay. So what is an English bond? Okay. Now this is the first course basically, and this is the second course. We have a video also. We will present the video, which will be more clearer for you to understand. What happens in an English bond? See, this is the stretcher. In the first course, what is happening? The bricks are, stretchers are facing the elevation. Second course, what is happening? The header is facing the elevation. So basically, English bond is a bond where you have alternate courses, header and stretcher. That is the definition of the English bond. One course, you have stretcher facing, and one course you have header spacing. Now, what is very important to understand in this is there is a element called queen closure. Okay, so what is this queen closure? See, queen closure is a cut brick. Okay, I just mentioned to you the queen closure there, that we are cutting a brick on the larger axis, on the lengthier axis. So that is a queen closure. Okay, so now why do we keep the queen closure here? Okay, see, in this also we have kept a queen closure in one course. When we have a header spacing on this side, we have kept a queen closure header facing. Okay, now why it is two members are required here? These two important members are required here. You can see the elevation of the courses. Okay, and you can see the 3D also, where you know we have tried to show one header course and one stretcher course. Okay, and the queen closure is seen here in this 3D also. Okay, now you see what happens is brick dimension. Let us observe the brick dimension. Okay, it's 1:2. Now, if we don't have this cut brick called the queen closure, what happens is, see, when I start placing these bricks now, see, this is equal to this. It is 230 by 115. Okay, so what happens is this brick, and above this I have two more bricks. Okay, what happens is, you know, I will ultimately I'll have a vertical joint. Okay, because the brick size is 1:2, 230 by 115. If I don't have one additional member called queen closure, so I'll end up having vertical joints in every course. Okay, so that is not, I've already told you in the beginning. Okay, so that is not a good sign. Having a vertical closure is not a vertical. To break the vertical joint, we use a cut brick called a queen closure. It is cut on the stretcher side. Okay. Siddharth, can you show that video? Yeah, that English bond video.
What is English bond? English bond is the most commonly utilized type of bond in masonry works. English bond in brick masonry consists of alternate stretcher course and a header course. Headers are laid centered on the stretchers in the course below and each alternate row is vertically aligned. After the first header, a coin closer is used in the beginning and end of a wall to break the continuity of vertical joints. A coin closer is a brick cut lengthwise into two halves and used at corners in brick walls. This type of bond is used to produce strong one brick thickness wall. Comment your views below, press like button and share the video. Finally, don't forget to subscribe our channel.
Yeah, these are some of the pictures. So this is the construction yard in Aditya actually. What we tried to, I mean, you have seen the video also and you have seen the presentation. Our students have really performed it on ground. So this is the exercise what we did in last semester. So this shows that students are working on the English bond, where we can see the alternate courses and you can see very clearly that the stretcher course, header course, and also you can see the queen closure here. So all these photos are just, you know, showing that, you know, our students are working on these bonds practically in the college. Okay, so that's next slide. Okay, moving further, one more important thing is, you know, see the brick, the thickness of this brick is called one brick thick. Okay, so what is one brick thick? See, usually one brick means it is 230 mm. So the brick length, the lengthwise brick is 230 mm. So when we have the brick wall of thickness 230 mm, it's called as one brick thick, or we call it as external wall or 230 mm wall. That is about English bond. I'm sure you got a fair idea of what the English bond is. Okay, so we just now saw the English bond, which is one brick thick. So now what is Flemish bond? Okay, I'll very crisply tell you what is Flemish bond. See, English bond was where you saw, you know, the stretcher in one course. But Flemish bond, you see one stretcher, one header, one stretcher, one header, one stretcher, one header, one stretcher, one header. So what is the Flemish bond? Basically, Flemish bond is in the single course, we have header and stretcher, header and stretcher. The English bond was alternate courses were header and stretcher. The Flemish bond is in the same course, we have stretcher, header, stretcher, header. So that is Flemish bond. So that is the basic difference between English and Flemish bond. Again, to break the vertical joint, we see these queen closures and all that, which in greater detail you can study later. But my job is to, you know, just give a introduction because of lack of time. I can't go more deeper into this topic. But I'll again conclude saying that, you know, English bond is a bond where alternate courses, you see header and structure. Flemish bond is a bond where you see alternate header and structure in every course. So whatever we're constructing, you know, this is called one course. This is the second course. So in the 3D, if you can see, this is the first course, second course, third course, fourth course. It's also called as odd course and even course. So they are the terminologies. Odd course is the first course, even course is the second course. And see, you can see bat here. Bat also is being used here. What is bat? I told you, when the brick is cut on the shorter direction, it is called bat, the cutting the brick like this. Okay. So in the Flemish bond, the member bat is used. See, in your Nata questions, a lot of questions are there. Okay. So bat is a member. Where is it used? In Flemish bond or English bond? So bat is a member which is used in Flemish bond. You can see this view here. This is the, yeah. These are some of the pictures, you know, which shows, you know, the exposed brickwork. The exposed brickwork, whatever is there. So this is what is the, you know, ultimately the building, how it looks when we have with these bonds. So I was just telling you about the wire cut bricks. So the advantage of wire cut bricks is, you know, we can expose the buildings like this. So these buildings don't have plastering. If you can see here, absolutely there is no plastering here. The bricks are exposed as it is. So this is the brick bonds. If you use these brick bonds here, so that is what is the advantage, what you can see. Siddharth?
Yes, sir.
No, should we start this this one or at the end we will give both the MCQs?
Sir, up to you, sir. You can have it now also.
Okay. Yeah, all of you are there. You have papers. Harshit, this one.
Yes, sir. We have
Aditya.
Papers. Yeah, sir. We have papers.
Yeah. Okay, please concentrate. Just you can put the question numbers. Okay, let us start the MCQ because it will be a break for you also instead of continuous listening. Okay. So we'll have the questions. Nothing you need to do. You take your pen, write MCQ phase one as the heading, write question number one. You need not even write the question. Write question number one and you please answer it. The first question is, in brick bonds, we use cut bricks to break dash joints. Horizontal joints, vertical joints, both or none. Okay. So you can just answer it. Second question is, structure has the maximum length of the brick. Structure has the maximum length of the brick. True or false? It's the second question. See, I want all of you to just, you know, you can take a screenshot also, and you can take a photo of this by chance if you have missed any question. All of you have written these two questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. See, if anything is there, you have to talk back, okay? Yeah. Let us go to the next slide, please. The third question. Okay. So I have just, you know, put this cut brick. This cut brick is called king closure, half pin closure, quarter closure, and bat. There are four options. This cut brick is called king closure, half pin closure, quarter closure, and bat. That is the fourth question. You guys have to just write the question number and write the answer. That's all. The most basic minimum you need to do. Can we proceed?
Okay, sir, yeah.
Okay, thank you. So the fifth question, you can see, courses of alternate header and structure is called dash bond. Flemish bond, English bond, header bond or structure bond. Fifth question is, I'll again repeat, you can parallelly write the answer actually, okay? So that, you know, we will save the time. The alternate courses of header and structure is called dash bond. The sixth question is, in a single course, you have alternate header and structure. What is that bond called? Even for your Nata exam, these questions are very, very important. I see them repeating many number of times. we have struggled very hard to put in, you know, a lot of important questions so that it will be useful for you guys. Fifth question, alternate courses of header and stretcher. Sixth question, in a single course, we have header and stretcher. You can take a snapshot here, especially these questions. Okay, I will give you some more time at the end. Next. Yeah. The seventh question, window top level in the building is called sill level, roof level, lintel level, or floor level. I'm again repeating the seventh question. Window top level in the building is called sill level, roof level, lintel level, or floor level. Eighth question, window bottom level in the building is called sill, roof, lintel, or floor level. Window bottom level is called sill, roof, lintel, or floor level. Kritika?
Yes, sir.
You guys are writing it?
Yes, yes.
No problem?
No problem, sir.
Okay, okay, thank you. Yeah, yeah. See, if anything is there, you please revert back, because you know, I'm expecting that all of you will send the questions, whatever you have written. Okay. Building without columns are called as dash structures. Okay. Building with columns and beams are called as dash structures. So the options are there for you. Frame structure, load bearing structure, sill and roof.
Sir? Sir?
Yeah, who is this?
Suhana.
Now, please tell me.
So actually, the spelling of sill should be S-I-L.
Yeah, yeah, no, I'll tell you. There's an interesting fact here. I'm very glad that you asked it. There is always a controversy of the spelling. Okay, see, Suhana, I'm very happy that you raised it. See, people write S-I-L-L also and C-A-L-L also, Suhana. You understand?
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, yeah, that's very nice. Yeah, there are two spellings for this. C-A-L-L also we write and S-A-L-L also we write.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, can you show me the first one, because I missed out the first one.
Yeah, 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 no problem. We'll take time and answer this properly, no problem.
Yes.
Yeah. We can spend 5 more minutes. We have time, no problem.
Yeah, done, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So, okay, it is to all the participants. This is called phase one. 10 questions are there. So before we move to it, I mean, have you all written it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, let us move on. So let us go to the next topic that is called, you know, I mean, all of you have, in fact, this picture is from my son's book. Okay, so all of you have studied in schools that there are different kinds of rock formation. Okay, so we have igneous rocks, we have metamorphic rocks, and we have sedimentary rocks. Okay, so the igneous rocks are formed inside the earth. Metamorphic rocks are formed by heat and pressure. Sedimentary rocks are the, you know, the topmost layer of the earth. So these three rocks, I mean, you must be wondering why these rocks are important for us. They're very, very important for us as an architectural material. Okay, especially flooring. Okay, you must have heard about granite, you must have heard about marble. I'm sure all of you have heard about it. So where do we get that from? So we get that from these rocks. Okay, that's where it becomes really important for us. So what are sedimentary rocks? Again, they are your meta questions. Please be, you know, attentive. What are sedimentary rocks? Sedimentary rocks are the types of rocks that are formed by deposition of minerals and organic particles in the earth's surface. Okay, what are igneous rocks? Igneous rocks is formed through the cooling and solidification of lava, basically. Okay, what are metamorphic rocks? The original rock is subjected to temperature greater than 150 to 200 degrees. So the metamorphic rocks should be again subjected to some temperature. So they are metamorphic rocks. Next slide, please. This is interesting. See, what are the igneous rocks? I mean, where does it fall important in our architecture as a material is? I'm sure all of you have heard about granite. Okay. Granite is an igneous rock. Okay. Granite, I mean, other rocks are not that heard of in our field. Mainly we use granite. Where do we use granite? We use granite for flooring, basically. You might have seen, I mean, some of your houses might have granite. Okay.
Okay.
So granite is used for flooring. Yeah, what is it? No, no problem. Let them draw. Okay. No, I mean, I've got used to it. So absolutely no problem. Let them draw whatever they want. Absolutely, there is no problem. Okay. So metamorphic rocks. So what are metamorphic rocks? The best example for metamorphic rock is marble. Okay. I mean, I'm sure you know Taj Mahal. Okay. Taj Mahal is made by marble. So it's a kind of metamorphic rock. Sedimentary rock, the best example is sandstone. So the few of these materials which we use extensively in architectural construction, they are part of these rocks. Yeah, igneous rocks, metamorphic rock, and sedimentary rocks. So granite is a igneous rock, marble is a metamorphic rock, and sandstone is a sedimentary rock. Okay, next. Okay, so now we have seen the rocks, right? So you guys have seen these jellies, what we call as jelly. So jelly is again a very important construction material. So we have 6 mm jelly, 12 mm jelly, and 40 mm jelly. So where is the jelly used? Can anybody tell? Kritika or Sandesh, I mean, I'm acquainted with these students now. Aditya, where do you use the jelly, word called jelly?
It is used in mixing with cement, sir.
Okay, next slide. Okay, so jelly is one. We actually use the jelly in concrete. Further slides I'll again explain to you. So basically now I'm touching upon the second material called stone, where you know the crushed jellies is the first part of the stone, which is very important for our construction, where we mainly use it for concrete. Okay. Again, I'll tell you what is concrete. So what is this structure? What can you see on the slide? See, this is the foundation. So stone as a material is used for foundation, very, very important. Especially in our load-bearing structures, we use stone foundation. It is called SSM. Okay, so stone foundation is also called SSM. So that is the you can see the stone walls laid here below the earth. Basically, they support our walls, whatever we are going to build above it. Okay, and we can also see, I mean, you might have seen some old buildings, the English time buildings, where stone as a material is used to build walls. Okay, stone is also used to build columns. We also have column stones. It may be decorative columns or to take load. I already told you that this is called sill, the bottom portion of the window. Top portion of the window is called lintel. You can see this ornamental usage of stone, where stone is used for lintel and sill also. And stone you have seen now as a material very importantly used for foundation works. And you can see this in this sketch, you can see the cut stones which are used here, and you can see some jelly also here, which is used for concrete. Yeah, next slide, please. So I've tried to list some common uses of stones. So stone as a building material used for foundation. Stone is used in construction of dams and so on, as we all know it. I'll mainly focus on the architectural uses of it. Stone is used as a raw material for making cement. It is used as a decorative material, I've already told you. It is also used as a part of building as such lintels and arches. Okay, so we have now seen stone as a building material. Basically, it is used, the crushed stone is used as a building material also. And as such, stone is also used as a building material, the full stone. Next. Okay, I think the material sand. Okay, so I'm very sure you guys are not seeing this material much often now. It's called river sand. Yeah, it has become really scarce, very scarce, and it's not available now. to a very large extent, it's not available. That is why today in construction, instead of river sand, we use something called M sand. Now, it's very important for students to understand what is M sand. Okay, it is a substitute of sand. So what is M sand? M sand is an artificial sand produced from crushing of hard stones into small sand sized angular pieces. The stone, whatever I told you, the jelly stones, they are first crushed, okay, and they are filtered to get this kind of M sand. Basically, it is a product of stone. The M sand what we are using in today's construction is a product of stone. So I'm again repeating, to a large extent, river sand is not available today. So we are using M sand instead of sand. Next. Yeah. See, now you can again put the jelly here. Okay. So let us cover this one more important material called cement. So I'm not getting into the details of how cement is produced and all that. I'm sure all of you would have heard the word called cement. So basically for concrete, we need to mix sand, okay, cement and aggregate. Okay. So this is cement, this is concrete. So all of you have seen this material called concrete, which is poured to make our roofs, to make our columns, to make our beams. You understand? So this is called concrete. So from what concrete is made from what? Cement, sand, and jelly. Okay, so that is what is the jelly what we, you know, saw before. So again, concrete is a very important component of our construction industry. So again, in cement, no, we have different grades. Okay, 33 grade, 43 grade, 53 grade, and all that, depending on the compressive strength. So 33, 43, 53 grade. So 53 grade is a better cement because it has better compressive strength than 33 grade. Cement is mainly produced from limestone and clay. Okay. Okay, I think the slide clearly shows that we have a concrete floor, we have concrete columns, okay, and see how they are mixing it, the concrete pour, okay, and you are also seeing the steel here. Okay, so now I would like to take some seconds here and explain to you. So there are different grades of concrete actually, M25, M20, M15, M10, M7.5, like that. Okay, now what is this? So what is one? What is one? What is 1:1:1? 1:1:2? So what are these ratios?
Cement, sand, and jelly.
Very nice, very nice, very good. So I'm very happy, Sadhvi. So Sadhvi says it is cement. So let us just compare this. One is cement. Next is sand. Sand or M sand, all are same. So what is happening here? Can you just observe in M25? What is happening? 1:1:2. Okay. In M20, what is happening is 1:1 is same. Okay. In M15, what is happening? 1:2:4. That means what? The cement is same. Okay. Sand is more, double, and jelly is 2 more times. So we can all understand by this that, you know, this is a more strengthier proportion of concrete because the cement proportion is more in it. Okay. See, one is cement everywhere. But you know, when you add more proportions of sand and jelly, you know, the cement becomes lesser. That's why we call 1:1:2 is the highest grade, that is M25 grade. But in today's buildings, minimum this grade we use. M15 is minimum, 1:2:4, okay? Or M20 is also used, 1:1.5:3, okay? To a very specific areas where we want more strength, yes, M25 is preferred. So the more we go, the more strength is there, the building can take better load of it. Okay. Now, a little bit about steel, you know. Okay. So what is this? All of you can still see steel here. Yeah. What is column? So column has concrete. Concrete, I've already told you the proportion of concrete. And this is called as tor steel. I don't know, that slide is somehow missing. Siddharth, can you see the next slide? Oh, back, that slide is somehow missing. Okay, no problem. I'll just see, there's something called tar steel. Okay, so all of you have heard about this word called tar steel, which is available in the market. Okay, so that is the steel basically used. It's a tensile material, and concrete is a compressive material. So when we say column or beam or slab, so we use concrete and steel together. So that can be seen here very clearly. I can see steel rods here, which are placed inside, that you can see. You can't see it from outside. If you just lift your head and see your own slab there, you won't see a steel because it is inside the concrete. So basically, steel and concrete both are mixed here. Okay, steel behaves as a tensile. Tensile means what? See, suddenly if there is an earthquake, okay, the roof will crack. So suddenly it won't fall on your head. So the steel which is there, it holds the concrete. That is called tensile. That's called tensile. Tensile means that rubbery filling, you know. It's called tensile, that rubber band filling, okay, which does not allow the roof to break and fall down. So the steel basically holds the concrete roof, okay, or the columns. So whenever we say these columns and beams, that's a frame structure, both these acting together is very important. One is steel and one is concrete. Okay, again, in steel we have it's called TMT, it's called the tar steel. Again, we have Fe415 and Fe500. Fe500 again is a better steel, which is having a better compressive strength, better tensile strength. So I think till here you are clear that concrete is an important building material, and steel is an important building material, the tar steel, which is available in different diameters. We have 6 mm, we don't use 8 mm, 10 mm, 12 mm, 16 mm, and 20 mm. So you can see these columns here, right? So usually we have heavy bars in the columns, okay, because they are the main component of the building. I think we have a video which will be very clear to you. I'll explain in between. Next, I think Siddharth, you play the video now. It's that fast. I think we're running out of time. So, kindly observe this video. I'll keep talking as the video is moving on. So now you can see the foundation. First we dig the whole earth. Okay, then we dig the foundation for the columns. This is called footing basically. Footing is coming up. Then columns have come up. These are the columns. You can see it with concrete. This is concrete. This is steel. So we were talking about plinth, right? So this is called plinth beam. You can see the plinth beam attaching to the columns, which makes our main support system. So on these plinth beams we build walls. So you have seen the footing, you have seen the concrete, column concrete. See this is a grid now. Now grid has been formed now. So the columns are raising from here. You can see these tying members called as beams. See the walls, what you can see here are just the infill panels. They are not load taking members. See, you can see this beam and column, they are the load taking members. Thank you. See, you can see the building complete. You can see the slab there. Again, the columns are raised for the first floor. Beams, slab. Again, the columns are raised for the third floor. So on and so forth. How many ever floors are there, the columns are raised. And finally, see, you can see a industrial shed. So industrial, you can see a slope roof. There's the windows. These are the walls, which act as a visual panel. Columns. I think you can stop the video with that. Or okay, let us see. We're running out of time, I felt. Yeah, it's almost done. Few more slides. See some material indications where, you know, the representations, I think we have gone through the NATA papers. So how the earthwork is shown, how the concrete is shown, how the masonry is shown. Next slide, Siddharth. I think material indication is also important. How the stone is shown, metal is shown. See wood, how the wood is shown. Okay, so all that is next. Yeah, you can see how the glass is shown, insulation, finishes, gypsum board. I mean, due to lack of time, you know, we can't spend more time on this. But this material indication, please keep in mind, it's very important for your NATA exams. See the wooden partition, steel sheets, see the tile indication and all that. Yeah, next. Yeah, next. Let us just, you know, there are a few slides, I think. Yeah. Okay. Oh, this is one of the building. I'll just take 5 minutes, which we have done as architects. So this building, you can see here, we have used mud blocks actually. Okay. They're the manufactured, they're called earth blocks. Okay. They're not bricks. They're called earth blocks. You can see the different kinds of material usage. Is that next? Yeah. You can see the ceiling. You know, we have kept some parts in the ceiling, the natural feature, and you can see the mud walls here. And this is a load-bearing structure, actually. There are no columns. Yeah, you can see the windows, the mud blocks. Yeah, you can see the staircase here. Again, a different kind of a material. Steel and wood we have used. And you can see these jali blocks. Yeah, next, Siddharth. Yeah, so you can see the different kinds of materials used in the building. Just for that sake, you know, I thought I'll just show you 4 or 5 slides. Yeah. I think quickly, students, please start writing down. So this is the last lap. 10 more questions are there. So the 11th question, 11, 12, 13, 14. You can take a picture, you know, you can take a photo of this. See, MCQ second phase. Granite is form of which rock? Igneous, metamorphic, sedimentary, hard rock. What should be the average height of the door? 7, 8.5, 5.5, 9.5. Identify the image. Where do we use this for? To indicate brick, wood, or tile, or paint. The 14th one is identify the given material. Cement block, granite block, wood, or sandstone. Yeah, let us have this, Siddharth, for 2 minutes. Let them just answer this. Guys, done?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you can take a picture also, okay? If you have any doubts again, you can slightly refer it again. Yeah, yes, move on to the next slide. Okay, man, thank you. So again, identify the material. Is it MDF, particle board, veneer, or fiber board? 15th question. 16th question. What kind of stone it is? Identify. 17th question, which among the following is the strongest? Lime, concrete, sand, or cement? Eighteenth question, which is not part of reinforcement cement concrete? Reinforced cement concrete is the slab what I explained to you. So which is not a part of that? Reinforced means steel. Identify the pattern. Yeah, sorry, because I don't think I mentioned that word. Reinforced means steel. Steel part of concrete is called, roof is called steel reinforcement. Next. Okay, identify this pattern. This pattern, where is it used for? So 10 more questions. This we are running out of time. So we had few more slides, but I don't think we can cover it. All of you have written?
Yes, sir.
Just scroll through. Let me just see. So wood has a material we have to cover, but you know, too many things. So I advise you to read on wood. Again, it's a natural material. So just scroll through fast. So hardwood and softwood. We'll scroll through fast. Hardwood, softwood. Yeah. So wood as a material. Yeah, let us go through. Something important I want to tell in the last. I think, Siddharth, just come to the plan section. What is plan? Yeah, that we'll just rush through this. Yeah. So I think, I'll just spend 5 minutes. So this is called actually plan of a building, plan of a house, where this is the entrance shown. These are the windows shown. Okay. The kitchen shown. I think, Siddharth, we'll go to the next slide. We'll explain them a simple bedroom. I think that is better. Yeah, yeah. So please see here, all of you know places where you are sitting. Okay, so this is the room. So what is this indication? This is a wall. Okay, so wall is breaking here. See, basically the plan, what is the plan? Plan is horizontal cutting the building. Okay, at 2.5 feet level, at window level. So you can see this view also. So basically when I cut something and see below, whatever I see is called plan. So what can I see here? I can see a wall here. I can see window here. So let me just draw the window. So I can see a window here. Again, the continuing wall here. And I see a door here. So wall on all the four sides. I see a door opening here. As soon as I come inside, what do I see? See a wardrobe here. See a bed placed here. Okay. Again, a study table placed here. And a working table here. And we have shown the chair in plan. So now by the end of the session, you need to understand what is plan, how to indicate a plan. Okay. So now can you tell me this plan and this view both are same? This view, is it the plan of this?
No.
Okay. Why no? See, because you know this window is shown here. Okay, and we don't have any window there. It's a blank wall. Okay, thank you, everybody. Okay. Hope thank it was an informative session. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
And all the best for all of you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Future universe, whatever it is, you know, you want to write Nata or whatever it is.
Thank you very much.
All the best. Please do well.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, sir. I'm sure that was an informative presentation for the students.